Chapter 14. The jackal rose at his habitual hour of 7:30, drank the tea placed by his bedside, washed, showered, and shaved. Once dressed, he took the wad of 1,000 pounds from inside the lining of his suitcase, slipped it into his breast pocket and went down for breakfast. At 9 o'clock he was on the pavement of the Via Manzoni outside the hotel, and striding down the road looking for banks. For 2 hours he went from one to another, changing the English pounds. 200 were changed into Italian lire and the remaining 800 into French francs. By mid-morning he was finished with this task, and broke for a cup of espresso on a cafe terrace. After that he set out on his second search. After numerous inquiries he found himself in one of the back streets off the Porta Garibaldi, a working-class area near the Garibaldi station. Here he found what he was looking for, a row of lock-up garages. One of these he hired from the proprietor who ran the garage on the corner of the street. The hire charge for 2 days was 10,000 lire, well above the odds, but then it was a very short let. In a local hardware store he bought a set of overalls, a pair of metal clippers, several yards of thin steel wire, a soldering iron and a foot of solder rod. These he packed into a canvas grip bought at the same store, and deposited the grip in the garage. Pocketing the key, he went off for lunch at a trattoria in the more fashionable center of the city. In the early afternoon, after making an appointment by phone from the trattoria, he arrived by taxi at a small and not too prosperous car hire firm. Here, he hired a second-hand 1962 vintage Alfa Romeo Sports two-seater. He explained that he wished to tour Italy for the forthcoming fortnight, the length of his holiday in Italy, and return the car at the end of that time. His passport and British and international driving licenses were in order, and insurance was arranged within the hour from a nearby firm which habitually handled the business of the hire car firm. The deposit was heavy, the equivalent to over £100, but by the mid-afternoon the car was his, the keys in the ignition, and the proprietor of the firm wishing him a happy holiday. Previous inquiries with the Automobile Association in London had assured him that as both France and Italy were members of the common market, there were no complicated formalities for driving an Italian registered car into France. Provided the driving licenses, car registration, hire documents and insurance cover were in order. From a personal inquiry at the reception desk of the Automobile Club Italiano on the Corso Venezia, he was given the name of a highly respectable insurance firm close by, which specialized in offering motor insurance cover for travel in foreign countries. Here he paid cash for extra insurance cover for an expedition into France. This firm, he was assured, enjoyed a mutual relationship with a large French insurance company, and their cover would be accepted without question. From here he drove the Alfa back to the Continental, parked it in the hotel car park, went up to his room and retrieved the suitcase containing the component parts of the sniper's rifle. Shortly after tea time he was back in the Mews Street where he had hired the lock-up garage. With the door safely shut behind him, the cable from the soldering iron plugged into the overhead light socket, and a high-powered torch lying on the floor beside him to illuminate the underside of the car, he went to work. For 2 hours he carefully welded the thin steel tubes that contained the rifle parts into the inner flange of the Alfa's chassis. One of the reasons for choosing an Alfa had been because a search through motor magazines in London had taught him that among Italian cars the Alfa possessed a stout chassis with a deep flange on the inner side. The tubes themselves were each wrapped in a thin sock of sacking material. The steel wire lashed them tightly inside the flange, and the places where the Wire touched the chassis edge were spot welded with the soldering iron. By the time he was finished, the overalls were smeared with grease from the garage floor and his hands ached from the exertions of heaving the wire tighter round the chassis. But the job was done. The tubes were almost undetectable, except to a close search made from underneath a car, and would soon be coated with dust and mud. He packed the overalls, soldering iron, and the remains of the wire into the canvas grip and dumped it under a pile of old rags in the far corner of the garage. The metal clippers went into the glove compartment set in the dashboard. Dusk was settling again over the city when he finally emerged at the wheel of the Alpha, the suitcase shut into the boot. He closed and locked the garage door, pocketed the key and drove back to the hotel. 24 hours after his arrival in Milan, he was again in his room, showering away the exertions of the day, soaking his smarting hands in a bowl of cold water, before dressing for cocktails and dinner. Stopping at the reception desk before going into the bar for his habitual Campari and soda, he asked for his bill to be made up for settlement after dinner, and for a morning call with a cup of tea at 5:30 the following morning. After a second splendid dinner, he settled the bill with the remainder of his lire, and was in bed asleep by shortly after 11. Sir Jasper Quigley stood with his back to the office, hands clasped behind him, and stared down from the windows of the Foreign Office across the immaculate acre of Horse Guards Parade. A column of household cavalry in impeccable order trotted across the gravel towards the Annexe and the Mall and on in the direction of Buckingham Palace. It was a scene to delight and to impress. On many mornings Sir Jasper had stood at his window and gazed down from the ministry at this most English of English spectacles. Often it seemed to him that just to stand at this window and see the blues ride by, the sunshine and the tourists' crane, to hear across the square the clink of harness and bit, the snort of a mettled horse and the oaths and ahs of the hoi polloi was worth all those years in embassies in other and lesser lands. It was rare for him that, watching this sight, he did not feel his shoulders square a little squarer, the stomach draw in a trifle under the striped trousers, and a touch of pride lift the chin to iron out the wrinkles of the neck. Sometimes, hearing the crunch of the hooves on gravel, he would rise from his desk just to stand at the neo-Gothic window and see them pass, before returning to the papers or the business of the state. And sometimes, thinking back on all those who had tried from across the sea to change the scene and supplant the jingle of the spurs with the tramp of brodequins from Paris or jackboots from Berlin, he felt a little pricking behind the eyes and would hurry back to his papers. But not this morning. This morning he glowered down like an avenging acid drop, and his lips were pressed so tightly together that, never full or rosy, they had disappeared completely. Sir Jasper Quigley was in a towering rage, and by a small sign here and there it showed. He was, of course, alone. He was also the head of France, not in the literal sense of possessing any jurisdiction over the country across the channel towards friendship with whom so much lip service had been paid and so little felt during his lifetime, but head of the bureau in the Foreign Office whose business it was to study the affairs, ambitions, activities and, often, conspiracies of that confounded place and then report upon them to the permanent undersecretary and, ultimately, to Her Majesty's Secretary of State for Foreign Affairs. He possessed, or he would not have got the appointment, all the essential requirements, a long and distinguished record of service in diplomacy elsewhere than France, a history of soundness in his political judgments which, although frequently wrong, were inevitably in accord with those of his superiors of the given moment, a fine record and one of which to be justly proud. He had never been publicly wrong, nor inconveniently right, never supported an unfashionable viewpoint or proffered opinions out of line with those prevailing at the highest Levels of the Core. A marriage to the virtually unmarriageable daughter of the head of Chancery. In Berlin, who had later become an assistant deputy under Secretary of State. Had done no harm. It had enabled an unfortunate memorandum in 1937 from Berlin advising that German rearmament would have no real effect in political terms on the future of Western Europe to be overlooked. During the war, back in London, he had been for a while on the Balkan desk and had forcefully counseled British support for the Yugoslav partisan Mikhailovich and his Setniks. When the Prime Minister of the time had unaccountably preferred to listen to the advice of an obscure young captain called Fitzroy MacLean, who had parachuted into the place and who advised backing a wretched communist called Tito, young Quigley had been transferred to France's desk. Here he had distinguished himself by becoming a leading advocate of British support for General Giroud in Algiers. It was, or would have been, a jolly good policy too, had it not been outmaneuvered by that other and less senior French general who had been living in London all the while trying to put together a force called the Free French. Why Winston ever bothered with the man was something none of the professionals could ever understand. Not that any of the French were much use, of course. No one could ever say of Sir Jasper, knighted in 61 for his services to diplomacy, that he lacked the essential qualification for a good head of France. He had a congenital dislike of France and everything to do with the place. These feelings had become, by the close of President de Gaulle's press conference of January 14, 1963, in which he barred Britain from the common market and caused Sir Jasper to have an uncomfortable 20 minutes with the minister, as nothing compared to his feelings towards the person of the French president. There was a tap on his door. Sir Jasper swung away from the window. From the blotter in front of him he picked up a piece of blue flimsy paper and held it as though he had been reading it when the knock came. Enter. The younger man entered the office, closed the door behind him and approached the desk. Sir Jasper glanced at him over the half-moon glasses. Ah, Lloyd. Just looking at this report you filed during the night. Interesting. Interesting. An unofficial request lodged by a senior French police detective to a senior British police officer. Passed on to a senior superintendent of the special branch, who sees fit to consult, unofficially of course, a junior member of the intelligence service. Yes, Sir Jasper. Lloyd stared across at the spare figure of the diplomat standing by the window, studying his report as if he had never seen it before. He had caught on it at least that Sir Jasper was already well versed in the contents, and that the studied indifference was probably a pose. And this junior officer sees fit, off his own bat and without reference to higher authority, to assist the special branch officer by passing on to him a suggestion. A suggestion, moreover, that without a shred of proof indicates that a British citizen thought to be a businessman may in fact be a cold-blooded killer. What the hell's the old buzzard getting at? Thought Lloyd. He soon found out. What intrigues me, my dear Lloyd, is that although this request, unofficial of course, is lodged yesterday morning, it is not until 24 hours later that the head of the department of the ministry most closely concerned with what happens in France gets to be informed. Rather an odd state of affairs, wouldn't you say? Lloyd got the drift. Interdepartmental pique. But he was equally aware that Sir Jasper was a powerful man, versed over decades in the power struggle within the hierarchy into which its component members habitually put more effort than into state business. With the greatest respect, Sir Jasper, Superintendent Thomas's request to me, as you say an unofficial one, was made at 9 last night. The report was filed at midnight. True, true. But I notice his request was also complied with before midnight. Now can you tell me why that was? I felt the request for guidance, or possible guidance as to a line of inquiry, only, came within the scope of normal interdepartmental cooperation, replied Lloyd. Did you now? Sir Jasper had dropped the pose of mild inquiry. And some of his pique was coming through. But not apparently within the scope of interdepartmental cooperation between your service and the France desk. You have my report in your hand, Sir Jasper. A bit late, sir. A bit late. Lloyd decided to riposte. He was aware that if he had committed any error in consulting higher authority before helping Thomas, it was his own chief he should have consulted, not Sir Jasper Quigley. And the head of the CIS was beloved by his staff and disliked by the mandarins of the FO for his refusal to allow anyone other than himself rebuke his subordinates. Too late for what, Sir Jasper? Sir Jasper glanced up sharply. He was not going to fall into the trap of admitting it was too late to prevent the cooperation with Thomas's request from being fulfilled. You realize, of course, that a British citizen's name is concerned here. A man against whom there is not a shred of evidence, let alone proof. Don't you think it a rather odd procedure to bandy a man's name and, in view of the nature of the request, reputation about in this manner? I hardly think divulging a man's name to a superintendent of the special branch simply as a possible line of inquiry can be described as bandying it about, Sir Jasper. The diplomat found his lips were pressed hard together as he sought to control his rage. Impertinent pup, but astute too. Needed watching very carefully. He took a grip on himself. I see, Lloyd. I see. In view of your evident desire to assist the special branch, a most laudable desire, of course, do you think it too much to expect you to consult a little before throwing yourself into the breach? Are you asking, Sir Jasper, why you were not consulted? Sir Jasper saw red. Yes, sir, I am, sir. That is exactly what I am asking. Sir Jasper, with the greatest deference to your seniority, I feel I must draw your attention to the fact that I am on the staff of the service. If you disagree with my course of conduct of last night, I think it would be more seemly if your complaint went to my own superior officer rather than to me directly. Seemly. Seemly. Was this young upstart trying to tell a head of France what was and what was not seemly? And it shall, sir, snapped Sir Jasper, and it shall. In the strongest terms. Without asking for permission, Lloyd turned and left the office. He had few doubts that he was in for a roasting from the old man, and all he could say in mitigation was that Bryn Thomas's request had seemed urgent, with time possibly a pressing matter. If the old man decided that the proper channels should have been gone through, then he, Lloyd, would have to take the rap. But at least he would take it from the OM and not from Quigley. Oh, damn Thomas. However, Sir Jasper Quigley was very much in two minds whether to complain or not. Technically he was right, the information about Calthrop, although completely buried in long discarded files, should have been cleared with higher authority, but not necessarily with himself. As head of France, he was one of the customers of CIS intelligence reporting, not one of the directors of it. He could complain to that cantankerous genius, not his choice of words, who ran the CIS, and probably secure a good ticking off for Lloyd, possibly damage the brat's career. But he might also get a dose of the rough edge of the CIS chief's tongue for summoning an intelligence officer without asking his permission, and that thought did not amuse. Besides, the head of CIS was reputed to be extremely close to some of the men at the very top. Played cards with them at Blades, shot with them in Yorkshire. And the glorious 12th was only a month away. He was still trying to get invited to some of those parties. Better leave it. The damage is done now, anyway, he mused as he gazed out over Horse Guards Parade. The damage is done now anyway, he remarked to his luncheon guest at his club. Just after 1 o'clock. I suppose they'll go right ahead and cooperate with the French. Hope they don't work too hard, what? It was a good joke and he enjoyed it very much. Unfortunately, he had not fully estimated his lunch guest, who was also close to some of the men at the very top. Almost simultaneously, a personal report from the Commissioner of Metropolitan Police and news of Sir Jasper's little bone MOT reached the Prime Minister's eyes and ears respectively just before 4 when he returned to 10 Downing Street after questions in the House. At 10 past 4 the phone in Superintendent Thomas's office rang. Thomas had spent the morning and most of the afternoon trying to track down a man about whom he knew nothing but the name. As usual when inquiring into a man of whom it was definitely known that he had been abroad, the passport office in Petit France had been the starting point. A personal visit there when they opened at 9 in the morning had elicited from them photostat copies of application forms for passports from 6 separate Charles Calthrops. Unfortunately, they all had middle names, and all were different. He had also secured the submitted photographs of each man, on a promise that they would be copied and returned to the passport office's archives. One of the passports had been applied for since January 1961, but that did not necessarily mean anything, although it was significant that no records existed of a previous application by that Charles Calthrop before the one Thomas now possessed. If he had been using another name in Dominican Republic, how come the rumors that had later linked him with Trujillo's killing had mentioned him as Calthrop? Thomas was inclined to downgrade this late applicant for a passport. Of the other 5, one seemed too old, he was 65 by the August of 1963. The remaining 4 were possibles. It did not matter whether they tallied with Lebel's description of a tall blonde, for Thomas's job was one of elimination. If all 6 could be eliminated from suspicion of being the jackal, so much the better. He could advise Lebel accordingly with a clear conscience. Each application form had an address, 2 in London and 2 in the provinces. It was not enough simply to ring up, ask for Mr. Charles Calthrop and then ask if the man had been in Dominican Republic in 1961. Even if he had been there, he might well deny it now. Nor were any of the 4 top listed suspects marked down as businessmen in the space for professional status. That too was not conclusive. Lloyd's report of a bar rumor at the time might call him a businessman, but that could well be wrong. During the morning, the county and borough police, after a telephone request by Thomas, had traced the 2 provincial Calthrops. One was still at work, expecting to go on holiday with his family at the weekend. He was escorted home in the lunch break and his passport was examined. It had no entry or exit visas or stamps for Dominican Republic in 1960 or 1961. It had only been used 2, once for Mallorca and once for the Costa Brava. Moreover, inquiries at his place of work had revealed that this particular Charles Calthrop had never left the accounts department of the soup factory where he worked during January 1961, and he had been on the staff for 10 years. The other outside London was traced to a hotel in Blackpool. Not having his passport on him, he was persuaded to authorize the police of his hometown to borrow his house key off the next door neighbor, go to the top drawer of his desk, and look at the passport. It too bore no Dominican police stamps, and at the man's place of work it was found he was a typewriter repair mechanic, who also had not left his place of work in 1961 except for his summer holidays. His insurance cards and attendance records showed that of the two Charles Calthrops in London, one was discovered to be a greengrocer in Catford who was selling vegetables in his shop when the two quiet-spoken men in suits came to talk to him. As he lived above his own shop, he was able to produce his passport within a few minutes. Like the others, it gave no indication that the possessor had ever been to Dominican Republic. When asked, the greengrocer convinced the detectives that he did not even know where that island was. The fourth and last Calthrop was proving more difficult. The address given in his application form for a passport 4 years previously was visited and turned out to be a block of flats in Highgate. The estate agents managing the block searched their records and revealed that he had left that address in December 1960. No forwarding address was known, but at least Thomas knew his middle name. A search of the telephone directory revealed nothing, but using the authority of Special Branch, Thomas learned from the General Post Office that 1CH Calthrop had an X directory number in West London. The initials tallied with the names of the missing Calthrop, Charles Harold. From there, Thomas checked with the registration department of the borough in which the telephone number was listed. Yes, the voice from the borough hall had told him, a Mr. Charles Harold Calthrop was indeed the tenant of the flat at that address, and was listed on the electoral roll as a voter of that borough. At this point, a visit was made to the flat. It was locked and there was no reply to the repeated rings on the bell. Nobody else in the block seemed to know where Mr. Calthrop was. When the squad car returned to Scotland Yard, Superintendent Thomas tried a new tack. The Inland Revenue was asked to check their records for the tax returns of one Charles Harold Calthrop, private address given, particular point of interest, who employed him, and who had been employing him over the past 3 years. It was at this point that the phone rang. Thomas picked it up, identified himself, and listened for a few seconds. His eyebrows lifted. "Me?" he asked. "What, personally?" "Yes, of course, I'll come over. Give me 5 minutes. "Fine, see you." He left the building and walked across to Parliament Square, blowing his nose noisily to clear the block sinuses. Far from getting better, his cold seemed to be worse, despite the warm summer day. From Parliament Square he headed up Whitehall and took the first left into Downing Street. As usual, it was dark and gloomy, the sun never penetrating to the inconspicuous cul-de-sac that contains the residence of the Prime Ministers of Britain. There was a small crowd in front of the door of number 10, kept on the far side of the road by two stolid policemen, perhaps just watching the stream of messengers arriving at the door with buff envelopes to deliver, perhaps hoping to catch a glimpse of an important visage at one of the windows. Thomas left the roadway and cut to the right across a small courtyard, enclosing a little lawn. His walk brought him to the back entrance of number 10, where he pressed the buzzer beside the door. It opened immediately to reveal a large uniformed police sergeant, who recognized him at once and saluted. "Afternoon, sir. Mr. Harrowby asked me to show you to his room directly." James Harrowby, the man who had telephoned Thomas in his office a few minutes before, was the Prime Minister's personal security chief, a handsome man looking younger than his 41 years. He wore a public school tie, but had a brilliant career as a policeman behind him before he was transferred to Downing Street. Like Thomas, he had the rank of a superintendent. He rose as Thomas entered. Come in, Bryn. Nice to see you. He nodded to the sergeant. Thank you. Chalmers. The sergeant withdrew and closed the door. What's it all about? Asked Thomas. Harrowby looked at him with surprise. I was hoping you could tell me. He just rang 15 minutes ago, mentioned you by name and said he wanted to see you personally and at once. Have you been up to something? Thomas could only think of one thing he had been up to, but he was surprised. It had got so high in such a short time. Still, if the PM did not wish to take his own security man into his confidence for once, that was his business. Not that I know of, he said. Harrowby lifted the telephone on his desk and asked for the Prime Minister's private office. The line crackled and a voice said yes. Harrowby here, Prime Minister. Superintendent Thomas is with me. Yes. Sir. Right away. He replaced the receiver. Straight in. Almost on the double. You must have been up to something. There. Are two ministers waiting. Come on. Harrowby led the way out of his office and down a corridor towards a green baize door at the far end. A male secretary was coming out, saw the pair of them, and stepped back, holding the door open. Harrowby ushered Thomas inside, said, clearly, Superintendent Thomas, Prime Minister, and withdrew, closing the door quietly behind him. Thomas was aware of being in a very quiet room, high-ceilinged and elegantly furnished, untidy with books and papers, of a smell of pipe tobacco and wood paneling. A room more like the study of a university don than the office of a Prime Minister. The figure at the window turned round. Good afternoon, Superintendent. Please sit down. Good afternoon, sir. He chose an upright chair facing the desk and perched on the edge of it. He had never had occasion to see the Prime Minister that close before, nor ever in private. He got the impression of a pair of sad, almost beaten eyes, drooping lids, like a bloodhound who has run a long race and taken little joy from it. There was silence in the room as the Prime Minister walked to his desk and sat behind it. Thomas had heard the rumor round Whitehall, of course, that the PM's health was not all it might be, and of the toll taken by the strain of bringing the government through the rottenness of the Keeler/Ward affair, which had even then only just ended and was still number one talking point throughout the land. Even so, he was surprised at the look of exhaustion and sadness in the man opposite him. Superintendent Thomas, it has come to my attention that you are presently conducting an investigation based on a request for assistance telephoned from Paris yesterday morning by a senior detective of the French police judiciaire. Yes, sir. Prime Minister. And that this request stems from a fear among the French security authorities that a man may be on the loose. A professional assassin, hired, presumably by the OAS, to undertake a mission in France at some future time. That was not actually explained to us, Prime Minister. The request was for suggestions as to the identity of any such professional assassin who might be known to us. There was no explanation as to why they wanted such suggestions. Nevertheless, what do you deduce from the fact that such a request was made? Superintendent. Thomas shrugged slightly. The same as yourself, Prime Minister. Precisely. One does not need to be a genius to be able to deduce the only possible reason for the French authorities wishing to identify such a specimen. And what would you deduce to be the eventual target of such a man? If indeed a man of this type has come to the attention of the French police. Well, Prime Minister, I suppose they fear an assassin has been engaged to attempt to kill the president. Precisely. Not the first time such an attempt would have been made. No, sir. There have been six attempts already. The Prime Minister stared at the papers in front of him as if they might give him some clues as to what had happened to the world in the closing months of his premiership. Are you aware, Superintendent, that there apparently exists some persons in this country, persons occupying not obscure positions of authority, who would not be distressed if your investigations were to be less energetic than possible? Thomas was genuinely surprised. No, sir. Where on earth had the PM got that tidbit from? Would you please give me a resume of the state of your inquiries up to the present time? Thomas began at the beginning, explaining clearly and concisely the trail from criminal records to special branch, the conversation with Lloyd, the mention of a man called Calthrop, and the investigations that had taken place up to that moment. When he had finished, the Prime Minister rose and walked to the window, which gave onto the sunlit square of grass in the courtyard. For long minutes he stared down into the courtyard, and there was a sag to the set of the shoulders. Thomas wondered what he was thinking. Perhaps he was thinking of a beach outside Algiers where he had once walked and talked with the haughty Frenchman who now sat in another office 300 miles away, governing the affairs of his own country. They had both been 20 years younger then, and a lot of things had not happened that were to come later, and a lot of things had not come between them. Maybe he was thinking of the same Frenchman sitting in the gilded hall of the Elysee Palace 8 months earlier, destroying in measured and sonorous phrases the hopes of the British Premier of crowning his political career by bringing Britain into the European community before retiring into the contentment of a man who has fulfilled his dream. Or possibly he was just thinking of the past agonizing months when the revelations of a pimp and courtesan had almost brought down the government of Britain. He was an old man, who had been born and brought up in a world that had its standards, for good or evil, and had believed in those standards and had followed them. Now the world was a different place, full of a new people with new ideas, and he was of the past. Did he understand that there were new standards now, which he could dimly recognize and did not like? Probably he knew, looking down onto the sunny grass, what lay ahead. The surgical operation could not long be delayed, and with it retirement from the leadership. Before long the world would be handed over to the new people. Much of the world had already been handed over to them. But would it also be handed over to pimps and tarts, spies and assassins? From behind, Thomas saw the shoulders straighten, and the old man in front of him turned round. Superintendent Thomas, I wish you to know that General de Gaulle is my friend. If there is the remotest danger to his person, and if that danger could emanate from a citizen of these islands, then that person must be stopped. From now on you will conduct your investigations with unprecedented vigor. Within the hour your superiors will be authorized by me personally to accord you every facility within their powers. You will be subjected to no limits in either expenditure or manpower. You will have the authority to co-opt onto your team whomsoever you wish to assist you, and to have access to the official documentation of any department in the land which may be able to further your inquiries. You will, by my personal order, cooperate without any hint of reserve with the French authorities in this matter. Only when you are absolutely satisfied that whoever this man may be whom the French are seeking to identify and arrest, he is not a British subject, nor operating from these shores, may you desist from your inquiries. At that point you will report back to me in person. In the event that this man Calthrop, or any other man bearing a British passport, may reasonably be considered to be the man whom the French are seeking, you will detain this man. Whoever he is, he must be stopped. Do I make myself clear? It could not have been clearer. Thomas knew for certain that some piece of information had come to the PM's ears that had sparked off the instructions he had just given. Thomas suspected it had to do with the cryptic remark about certain persons who wished his investigations to make little progress. But he could not be sure. "Yes, sir," he said. The PM inclined his head to indicate the interview was over. Thomas rose and went to the door. "Er. Prime Minister. Yes. There is one point, sir. I am not certain whether you would wish me to tell the French yet about the inquiries into the rumor about this man Calthrop in Dominican Republic 2 years ago. Do you have reasonable grounds to believe as of now that this man's past activities justify fitting him to the description of the man the French wish to identify?" "No, Prime Minister. We have nothing against any Charles Calthrop in the world except the rumor of 2 years ago. We do not yet know whether the Calthrop we have spent the afternoon trying to trace is the one who was in the Caribbean in January 1961. If he is not, then we are back to square one." The Prime Minister thought for a few seconds. "I would not wish you to waste your French colleagues' time with suggestions. Based on unsubstantiated rumors 2.5 years old. Note the word unsubstantiated, Superintendent. Please continue your inquiries with energy. At the moment you feel there is enough information in your possession concerning this, or any other, Charles Calthrop, to add substance to the rumor that he was involved in the affair of General Trujillo, you will inform the French. At once and at the same time track the man down, wherever he is." "Yes, Prime Minister. And would you please ask Mr. Harrowby to come to me? I shall issue the authorities you need at once." Back in Thomas's office, things changed quickly through the rest of the afternoon. Round him he grouped a task force of 6 of the special branch's best detective inspectors. 1 was recalled from leave, 2 were taken off their duties watching the house of a man suspected to be passing classified information obtained from the Royal Ordnance Factory where he worked on an East European military attaché. 2 of the others were the ones who had helped him the day before go through the records of the special branch looking for a killer who had no name. The last had been on his day off, and was gardening in his greenhouse when the call came through to report to the branch headquarters. Immediately, he briefed them all exhaustively, swore them to silence, and answered a continuous stream of phone calls. It was just after 6 p.m. when the Inland Revenue found the tax returns of Charles Harold Calthrop. 1 of the detectives was sent out to bring the whole file back. The rest went to work on the telephone, except 1 who was sent to Calthrop's address to seek out every neighbor and local tradesman for information as to where the man might be. Photographs taken from the one submitted by Calthrop on his application form for a passport 4 years previously were printed in the photographic laboratory. And every inspector had one in his pocket. The tax returns of the wanted man showed that for the past year he had been unemployed, and before that had been abroad for a year. But for most of the financial year 1960-1 he had been in the employ of a firm whose name Thomas recognized as belonging to one of Britain's leading manufacturers and exporters of small arms. Within an hour he had the name of the firm's managing director, and found the man at home at his country house in the stockbroker belt of Surrey. By telephone Thomas made an appointment to see him immediately, and as dusk descended on the Thames his police Jaguar roared over the river in the direction of the village of Virginia Water. Patrick Monson hardly looked like a dealer in lethal weapons, but then, Thomas reflected, they never do. From Monson, Thomas learned the arms firm had employed Calthrop for just under a year. More important, during December 1960, and January 1961 he had been sent by the firm to Ciudad Trujillo to try and sell a consignment of British Army surplus submachine guns to Trujillo's police chief, Thomas Edmondson, with distaste. And never mind what they later get used for, boyo, he thought, but did not bother to voice his distaste. Why had Calthrop left Dominican Republic in such a hurry? Monson seemed surprised by the question. Well, because Trujillo had been killed, of course. The whole regime fell within hours. What could be expected from the new regime by a man who had come to the island to sell the old regime? A load of guns and ammunition? Of course he'd had to get out, Thomas pondered. Certainly it made sense. Monson said Calthrop had later claimed he was actually sitting in the office of the dictator's police chief, discussing the sale when the news came through that the general had been killed in an ambush outside the town. The chief of police had gone white and left immediately for his private estate, where his aircraft and pilot were permanently waiting for him. Within a few hours, mobs were rampaging through the streets, seeking adherents of the old regime. Calthrop had to bribe a fisherman to sail him out of the island. Why, Thomas asked eventually, did Calthrop leave the firm? He was dismissed, was the answer. Why? Monson thought carefully for a few moments. Finally he said, Superintendent, the second-hand arms business is highly competitive. Cutthroat, you might say. To know what another man is offering for sale, and the price he is asking, can be vital for a rival wishing to clinch the same deal with the same buyer. Let us just say that we were not entirely satisfied with Calthrop's loyalty to the company. In the car back into town, Thomas thought over what Monson had told him. Calthrop's explanation at the time as to why he had got out of Dominican Republic so fast was logical. It did not corroborate, indeed it tended to negate, the rumor subsequently reported by the Caribbean CIS resident that his name was linked with the killing. On the other hand, according to Monson, Calthrop was a man who was not above playing a double cross. Could he have arrived as the accredited representative of a small arms company wishing to make a sale, and at the same time have been in the pay of the revolutionaries? There was one thing Monson had said that disturbed Thomas. He had mentioned that Calthrop did not know much about rifles when he joined the company. Surely a crackshot would be an expert? But then of course he could have learned that while with the company. But if he was a newcomer to rifle shooting, why did the anti-Trujillo partisans want to hire him to stop the general's car on a fast road with a single shot? Or did they not hire him at all? Was Calthrop's own story the literal truth? Thomas shrugged. It didn't prove anything, nor disprove anything. Back to square one again, he thought bitterly. But back at the office there was news that changed his mind. The inspector, who had been inquiring at Calthrop's address, had reported in. He had found a next-door neighbor who had been out at work all day. The woman said Mr. Calthrop had left some days before and had mentioned he was going touring in Scotland. In the back of the car parked in the street outside, the woman had seen what looked like a set of fishing rods. Fishing rods? Superintendent Thomas felt suddenly chilly, although the office was warm. As the detective finished talking, one of the others came in. Super. Yes. Something had just occurred to me. Go on. Do you speak French? No, do you? Yes, my mother was French. This assassin the PJ are looking for, he's got the codename Jackal, right? So what? Well, Jackal in French is Chacal. C-H-A-C-A-L. See? It could just be a coincidence. He must be as thick as five posts to pick a name, even in French. That's made up of the first three letters of his Christian name and the first three letters of his. Land of my bloody fathers, said Thomas, and sneezed violently. Then he reached for the telephone. End of the chapter 14.